Hello YouTube. In this video we're going to take another look at the Deskpro XE 466. And today we're going to be fiddling around a little bit with the IDE controller that's on the system. Because, as you can probably tell, there is currently no hard drive installed. It's supposed to go here with this IDE cable there. But that cable is too short, so I ordered an extension in order to get the cable connected there. I hope this works, because this is my last resort to ever get a combination working between the CDROM drive and the internal hard drive on one IDE channel, because the CMOS battery is flat and it needs to be desoldered. I cannot do that myself. It has no priority to get that done either. But if I add another IDE card, I get all kinds of problems, because I get RQ conflicts on the IDE controllers themselves. And I can't find a decent, affordable card that only has an IDE port. So I either have to get a controller card accompanied with a CD-ROM drive that are pretty much certified to work together, or this needs to work. I've also tried compact flash adapters, SD adapter, with all kind of stuff, but they will not become bootable on the system. It will just say, nope, we're not going to do that. So now I just need to get the hard drive for this. Let's see. Great stack of hard drives. That's a Fireball. That's a Toshiba SATA drive, 1 terabyte, 20 gig. Let's see here. That's a Medalist. This is the original drive that was in it. So yeah. Well, in that case, I don't even know where the drive is. Okay, I'm gonna get all the things I need and we'll see if we can get it working. All right, we've got a righteous old mess here. I found a drive. Here's a quantum drive that I wanted to use in the system. And it has the current image of Windows 95 version A on it. Installed from floppy disk. Oh yeah. In my case, I had to use regular high-density disks, which means you actually have to write 21, I think, of them, instead of the regular 14. They are special MFD disks, or MDF, I can't remember. I think they were MFD. So yeah, I didn't have the retail disks, I only had the images, so that really sucked. And now we need to get this thing in there. Not going in without a fight, apparently. Well, I guess we have to just pull it down and then pull it up again. However, yeah, there we go. Just need to find a way to line up the holes. Let's see, let's do the bottom right first, because this corner seems to be the most unstable. Interesting design. I guess if you wanted to, you could probably fit two drives if you got a couple slimline drives in there. Just gonna tighten these two first so we've got that in place. I haven't actually figured out a way to mount a CD-ROM yet, because it didn't actually include a caddy or something. I'm gonna see if I can maybe reuse the caddy that came with my HP Vectra. Now it's a long shot. HP and Compaq weren't merged at this point in time, so it didn't happen until the early 2000s. So it's a long shot, but the only thing I have to go on for now. If I can't do that, I'll just have to velcro it to the case. Maybe not quite as elegant, but hey, if it'll work, then that'll be fine with me. Alright, so this blue end needs to be connected to the motherboard. The slot on this particular motherboard is already keyed, so that's good. Let's see, I'm going to use this Molex cable to power the hard drive. go. And this end has to connect to the hard drive as well. The thing we want to look for as soon as we power the system on is whether the drive comes on or not. If it doesn't, then the cable doesn't work properly. In that case, I'm pretty boned. All right. This female connector isn't properly keyed, so either I have to completely remove one of the pins or use a different cable for now. We're gonna do the latter. I've only got one chance of actually ruining the damn thing, so this is a standard unkeyed cable. I can use this. Orientation doesn't quite matter. I think pin 40, that's the red line. Yep, that's okay, that's correct. Okay, and then we need to reverse that on the motherboard to follow the keys on the board. There we go. Again, this is just a test to see whether this works. I will leave the floppy drives and everything else disconnected. And we're now just going to connect it to the monitor and see if we can get it to boot from the drive. If it can boot from the drive now in this configuration, we know this extension cable does what it's designed to do. And that way we can connect up the regular IDE connection after removing one of the pins and then continue on as normal. Okay, now we can see what happens. It will complain about the floppy drive not being connected. That's normal, because the BIOS is just running at default settings. It's currently connected to my KVM switch, that way I don't have to actually remove one of the pins on my VGA cable in order to run the system. Because this uses a 14-pin D-sub instead of the regular 15-pin D-sub for VGA. This has one of the holes missing for modern VGA cables. Older VGA monitors, such as the CRTs of the time, only had 14-pin connections, so they work just fine. Okay. Now it's gonna go through that one more time. By the way, like I said, we wanted to listen to see if the disk would spin up, and it hasn't. So we might as well actually troubleshoot that on the bench right now, because I may have just hooked up the IDE cable backwards. I'm gonna try that first. Change them around. See if it made a difference. No spin up on the disk either. Okay. Let's connect it properly backwards. Okay, that spins up the disk. So I guess I was on at the wrong end here. Makes no sense, but hey, if it was gonna work. The only thing I'm asking of you right now is just to boot and see if the hard drive will be bootable at all. If that's the case, then all we need to do is get that pin removed and connect it to the optical drive. But at least there is a connection between this and the motherboard right now, so that's something new. That's going to do the memory count again. This always happens on a cold boot. And we should boot into Windows after this. I'll hold my hand on the cone because the internal speaker in this is quite loud, as you notice. The annoying thing is it pauses right here. And usually when I've got everything connected properly, it will not pause. It will go straight to booting from the internal hard drive. There we go. We're going to ignore the changes. The problem now is it's not doing anything. Then we're gonna try next. It's connected properly to the adapter, because I'm absolutely 100% certain that's connected properly. I'm going to connect it backwards to the motherboard. But first we're gonna try to connect it properly again. Maybe I missed something and I'm just a dumbass. Well, I sort of am. And for good measure, we're just gonna connect the floppy drive again, because we'll at least get rid of that error. It's connected to power, all right. Okay. Just need to double check. Can't be too sure, but I'm pretty certain we need to connect it up this way. Okay, we've got hard drive spin up, so I guess I put it backwards on the motherboard end. The floppy drive is now connected as well. For good measure, we've got a floppy drive in place, just in case. This is gonna be a... whoops. See, it posted much, much more quickly there. There was no timeout waiting to happen. I've got a good feeling about this round. Perhaps I'm just a dumbass that connects their shit up wrong. There we go, that's a quick post. Now we get clearance to boot up. Yup, starting Windows 95, okay. So now we've at least established that the adapter cable is working. It's working as advertised, it's booting into the OS. Might have just ruined it by actually lifting the cable. No, I didn't, okay, good. It's still loading. I mean, it's a 486DX2, what do you expect? It's not exactly going to boot like it has an SSD or something. There we go. It's correct, there's no mouse connected. There are no speakers connected either, but it will bleep through the internal one. Or well, not even only bleep. Okay, as you can see, bare bones installed Windows 95 with drivers. So, at least we know that much. Let's shut it down. So we know this adapter is going to work, now we just need to make sure that the cables work. There we go. So that's the next step, and then we can make the optical drive work. So I'm going to actually experiment with the cables a bit, cut the right pin. I'm not going to do that on camera. And then we'll get back to the new situation and see if we can get the CD-ROM drive working in conjunction as well. Alright, so this is the final test, essentially. It's connected to the red cable now. I've removed one of the pins. Disk is spinning up. Optical drive is powered. We still have an image on the screen, counting up the RAM. Again, going to cover up the... there we go. There we go, normal boot, normal post. Just a regular BIOS error so it can't keep time and date. That's just fine. Okay. Permission to boot. There you go. Gonna boot into 95. Well, just for good measure, I know this is a heap. It looks like shit, but I'll have to work on getting all those ribbon cables tucked away nicely in the case. At least the hottest component, which is right there, the CPU, is in good shape there. Okay, let's hit the enter key with my foot. Key. Just trying to find a D or a CD-ROM here in the background. Alright, found the nice embarrassing one. Let's put that in there. And see if it's gonna do something. Oh, for some reason the keyboard stopped working. Oh, there it is. Whatever that means. Yep, drive E is the CD-ROM drive. Let's open the drive up. We can go into setup for this piece of software. Sponsored by a Dutch bank. This computer, I don't think, meets the minimum requirements for this particular software, but it's from 1998. It's a music tracker where you can mix your own effects and all kinds of stuff like that. But we're gonna quit, because all we needed to know was whether the CD-ROM drive worked at all. Ah, don't you just love that? Okay, take it easy. I'll have to put a warning for headphone users in, but I surely won't remember that while editing. I'm gonna cancel that. And now we've got an illegal operation, and it's terminated. Okay, just for good measure, we need to verify that the floppy drive is still operational, that I hooked that up correctly. So let's take a look at that. It now thinks we have a 5 1/4 inch floppy drive B. That probably means that it has absolutely no freaking idea what's connected at this point. And it is most certainly not working. Well, that's perfectly clear. I wired the floppy drive up backwards, so I'm on board. Okay, well, I can easily fix that. I didn't actually look at the keying on the socket, so that's just my bad. I aligned a wrong pin. That's great. Anywho, I'm gonna do the tidying up of the cables, get the floppy drive up and running again, and we'll take a look at the finished product once I'm all done. And from that point onward, we can actually start using the 486 again. And this product has been going like this for the past month. I've been waiting for packages from China for about, well, 2 months actually. And I was getting pretty tired of it. I mean, I really wanted this system to work, so in the meantime, to adhere to my retro needs, I just decided to build that Pentium 2 machine. So now we're gonna continue with this one. Anyways, like I said, I'm gonna tidy things up, and through the magic of video editing, this will only take a couple seconds for you, but it's gonna take a long time for me. Alright, it's booted up now. So, well, now we just need to test the system. We know the floppy drive works, so that's working properly. Now we just need to give the CD-ROM another test run. We're going to be installing and playing a game called Scunny, which looks like this. Essentially a Sonic knockoff, if you want to call it that. But I used to play this as a kid, so I really liked it. It requires the actual processor that's in this machine, so it should run okay. It is Windows compatible. It requires a 486DX, 66 MHz with VGA monitor, MS-DOS 5 or higher, 8 MB of RAM, and 17 MB of disk space. It is compatible with the Creative Sound Blaster. That's what we have, so that's good. I'm going to go full installation. I'm going to put it on the D drive. Whoops. That's a 1 GB partition where I'm going to store the DOS games. Now we just need to actually pay attention to the screen. I'll move you guys a bit closer. The onboard video should be able to cope with this just fine. Currently running 1024, 768, 256 colors. So that's pretty good for onboard video in 1994. I actually found a date stamp in the case that actually said that this thing was made in February 8th of 1994. So just turned 23, which is good. Which is coincidental because I'm also 23 right now. Except I was born on January 14th. So that's a little bit of a trivia there. And now this is going to take some time. Because of programmed I/O, one subset of data from CD-ROM to IDE controller, and then from IDE controller back to the hard drive, one sector at a time, more or less. Well, the problem is that I have to, the CPU needs an interrupt for every single time data has to be written from one device to the other. So that's pretty inefficient. That's why we got DMA these days. Anyways, in the meantime, I actually discovered that this installation of Windows 95 is very, very, very barren. It didn't even install the original sound scheme. It only has the Microsoft sound. So that's pretty sad. I'm gonna have to burn a couple CDRWs and get some data to this thing. It also has a network card, which does not work, unfortunately. That's quite sad, because I do have a dedicated file server virtual machine running on my ESXi server. But this thing does not seem to want to connect. So that's pretty much what that next hub was for, that I showed a couple of videos ago. So I'm gonna have to check and see if that thing can actually make this thing work. Because that would be awesome. If it does, then I'll definitely keep that next hub around for future retro projects. But yeah, I'm gonna wait for this to finish and then we can start up the game and have some fun. Right, so we can actually start playing a game now. Let's close that down to D drive, to the Scunny folder, and set up the audio. There we go. This game is from 1995. Microchef, wind blows detected. Yup. Let's see, do we have anything? Yeah, on top. Sound blaster. Two speakers. This is a Sound Blaster 16 to 30. Well, that can't be right. Just need to verify the addresses. Let's get it to the system. Device manager. Let's see your sound. Sound Blaster 16, plug and play. Apparently we're running a default driver. Oh dear god, it totally fucked up the addresses. Right. The Windows sound system compatible is conflicting. Okay. I'm gonna replace this regardless. We want the ideal default addressing mode, which is 5015. 0.02 or 220, 330, that's all right. Yes, I know it's manual, I know it's gonna conflict. I don't give two shits. No, I don't want to print that. Properties. Okay, this one switched addresses now. Good. Okay, let's see if we can actually use these addresses now. DMA1, DMA5, RQ5. There we go. Let's test the sound card. Yep, that's working. The sound is working as well. Save and exit. Okay. So that works. Now we just need to make sure that the MIDI playback is actually turn it all the way up. There we go. So we can actually hear something in the game. I'll just say this, I haven't played this game since, well, probably the late 90s, so I never was much good at it. I always watched my sister play this, so be aware. That's all I'm saying. We just need to wait for this to load up. I guess we just have to wait for this to load up. Then again, the system only barely meets the minimum requirements, so. Do this. Was a low dead level. There we go. No idea to get down, honestly. This is embarrassing. Let's reload the level. Oh dear god. Alright. I'll say this much, this actually plays pretty well, things considered. Alright. Well, we can conclude that it is now running beautifully. So that concludes this video as well. Hope you enjoyed this video, and I thank you all for watching.